So, side-lobe contamination. It doesn't sound that interesting in terms of, you know, sort of this scientific idea of a contamination side-lobe. What's this? I want to just look at cool stuff like tornado debris signatures and all that. Well, we see pretty frequently instances of contamination from this feature known as the side-lobe that really affects our velocity data and our velocity signatures and can lead you astray pretty quickly. Do you have a velocity couplet and low reflectivity, for instance, and you think, ooh, maybe I'm about to issue a tornado warning, or I'm on air and I'm going to start telling people, it looks like a tornado is about to form here. Beware the side lobe, and we'll show you what we're talking about here. So let's imagine our radar is at that base scan. We're pointing at 0.5 degrees. We're looking at a nice big supercell in the distance. It even looks like we have a wall cloud down here. And there's our radar scan, and we get all our information back. Reflectivity, KDP, CC, all that stuff comes back to the radar and we get information. Everything, it works the way we want it to work. You have what's going on with the radar due to the construction of the radar, the dish, the way things are shaped, the dome, what's known as these weaker lobes from an imperfect radiation pattern. As we radiate the energy out from the radar, we get this imperfect pattern. You get things known as side lobes. As you can see here, this extra lobe, and this isn't just going on top, it's also going on to the sides, beneath. We're getting these things known as side lobes. If we imagine, though, with our radar data we're getting back, generally we just get weak returns back from the side lobe. That pattern that's going out, that extra energy that's going out to other areas besides where our dish is actually pointed, it's a very low energy that's going out in that direction. So generally, if there's not much there, we're not too concerned about it. What we're getting back is going to be generally from our main lobe, where the radar is pointed. We only get weak returns from the side lobe. We get lots of good returns from our main lobe. And so what we see on radar is what we're expecting where we're looking, and everything's fine. It works out just as we would expect it to work out. And what we see on radar image is dominated by the returns from the main lobe. So in this instance, our radar is pointed down here. What we see on radar is what we're actually pointing our radar at. So it works very nicely. We're going to change our example, though, and we're going to open the door, if you will, or open the door on our supercell. It's pretty cool that you can actually do that and lift it open and then reveal the updraft inside and all of our growing precipitation particles. Corny, I know, but you got to stick with me here. So we have our growing hailstones, some of maybe our drier hailstones or grapple, and then we also have our raindrops at some warmer temperatures here. We don't have much precipitation, at least we can imagine. Maybe we don't have much precipitation, though, down low where our main lobe is looking. Again, our radar is pointed at 0.5 degrees, pointed down low. So what happens? Well, we actually have a pretty good amount of returns in our side lobe, this area where our radar's not pointed, but there's still energy going out there, but it's running into really big stuff, big hailstones, a lot of stuff. Now what goes on is those returns from the side lobe, because there's a lot of stuff where the side lobe is pointing at, they can dominate the total signal that comes back to the radar. And what we end up seeing on radar is actually somewhat of a contribution from the side lobe and not the main lobe. So suddenly, where our radar is looking, we're getting information about somewhere else, and now the whole game has changed. And we see these radar images that have contaminated data. So let's look at an example. Rich knows this example well, at least from Elko, Nevada. We're heading west out to Nevada, not a typical area when we're looking at supercells, but we have our nice area of reflectivity here, very high values of reflectivity, supercell. And we look here, and something of interest. We see our inbounds here, our radar is to the northwest. Our outbounds here, outbounds next to inbounds. It's kind of in the right spot. Looks like maybe we have rotation here. But before jumping to conclusions, let's check how the signature aligns with reflectivity at 0.5 degrees. So we're going to highlight our area where we have those strong inbounds, and we're going to slide our reflectivity over. We see it's in an area about 10 to 25 dBz within the inflow region. OK, so we'll make a mental note of that. Look at correlation coefficient now. Correlation coefficient, those values aren't too high. Remember, we're using it to make sure we can trust these data here. We see values, A, that are pretty noisy, and then also they're starting to get pretty low as we deal with values below 0.7. So that's strike one on whether we can trust these information. Let's look at ZDR real fast. ZDR, you know, areas where we have similar levels of reflectivity, 20 to 30 dBz or so. It's nice and smooth, generally about 0.5 to 1 dB, but then we look down here in areas of 20 to 30 dBz reflectivity, and looks like instead what we got there is some kind of speckly ZDR, noisy ZDR. It doesn't look like what we'd expect from nice meteorological returns. So we still are just not too sure about this. That's going to be strike two. We're going to take a look at something called spectrum width. We introduced this briefly in the first overview of radar in general. And spectrum width is telling you something about sort of what is the variability of velocity within our radar range bins. Is it very turbulent, a lot of different velocities, or is it nice and smooth? Are we seeing a nice area of kind of one sort of smooth area of velocity, or velocity values at least? What we see here is sort of these areas of high spectrum width where it looks like there's a lot of variance in our velocity within these radar range bins. So there's a lot of maybe turbulence, or perhaps even there's a lot of contributions from different areas of a storm. I'm sort of getting at an idea there. So whatever it tells you, it's that it just doesn't look as clean as what we're seeing in the rest of the storm. And so that's strike three, at least. So we're getting close to spring training, and so three strikes, you're out. Let's take a look at higher altitudes to check if the side lobe contamination is possible here. We already feel pretty uneasy about this reflectivity, about this velocity signature based on all these other data. So we look up top, and we have the same area circled, so we're not moving it, we're not changing the game on you, we're still looking in the same spot. Our area of reflectivity aloft is much higher, about 50 dBz. So it's this high reflectivity aloft, it looks like, again, if we're pointing down low, on our previous scan, and then we're looking up top on this current scan, we're actually physically looking up top to get an idea of what's up there, but on our previous scan, we're looking down low, all of that stuff that's up there that we're seeing in this scan higher up, that could be interfering with what we're looking at down low. So that could be causing potential side lobe issues. Sure enough, when we bring it back down to the surface, when our radar is actually scanning at 0.5 degrees, nice close to the ground, our reflectivity is low, about 20 dBz. So you can see how those overlap each other. You have lots of stuff overlapping, not much stuff down low. And so when our radar is actually pointing down low at that area of not much stuff, our weak side lobe that's looking up here, that usually is not a problem because it's so weak, is actually getting a lot back in return relative to what we're getting where the radar is actually pointing. So our side lobe signal is so strong that it's contaminating our low-level velocity signature, and we can't trust it. We don't actually have a rotational, we have a rotational signature here, but it's not actually representing strong rotation in our thunderstorm at this level. So side lobe contamination, while rare, these returns can contaminate radar images, and we want to know when they pop up. The greatest impact is usually with velocity data in the supercell inflow area. That's where we tend to see it pretty frequently. What we want to do, though, is look for consistency in the data in both space and time. We want to see how it evolves over different variables. We want to see how it evolves over time. Is it jumpy? Is it noisy? Or is it a nice, smooth signal? If it's a nice smooth signal, we know we can trust it more. However, if it's really noisy or jumpy, and it just doesn't match up, doesn't make sense in our heads, then we perhaps see what is known as side lobe contamination or significant side lobe contamination from higher up in a storm, and that may give us a velocity image that we actually can't trust. And so if we suspect contamination, we need to use those variables, especially for velocity data, with quite a bit of caution. And with that, we wrap up our side lobe contamination module.